Pleasant good evening to everyone. I was going to say a pleasant balmy good evening, but you already know how I feel. First, I want to say thanks to all those who do the heavy lifting, the planners and those working in registration and the audio, the praise band, all those who help make this such a splendid event. And I've had no small amount of you say to me that this was the best and it's not over. And I think you've all noticed that the caliber of teaching and speaking and instruction here is at a notch higher. As Emeril Lagasse says, we kicked it up a notch. And I'm glad you all appreciate that. You can see the title of my presentation this evening is Ultimate Irony, the Hokey Pokey is What It's All About. Now, I was going to ask how many have danced the Hokey Pokey, but I can't see you, even if you all raised your hands. But I imagine that you all have danced it. And I pray my captivating title does not outdistance what I present to you this evening. But I came by the title as I was driving in my Ford pickup truck. And I was driving down the road, and I saw a bumper sticker that said, honk if you love peace and quiet. And that sort of put me in the ironic mode. And then I saw another bumper sticker that said, what if the Hokey Pokey is what it's all about? And I was in that mode of irony, and I said, yeah, I think that's going to be my title. Because, you know, exaggeration is a billion times worse than understatement. As many of us now are focusing on retirement, or at least having retirement funds, is really what I mean. The government's telling us when we can start collecting and how much. So as we've been focusing on that, I've been troubled that the guy who invests all our money is called a broker. And I thought, I'm stuck in this mode of irony. And of course, there are times I think through the course of human history, in your lifetime and mine, there, by way of introduction, have been a few occasions of tremendous irony. You might recall the great Exxon Valdez oil spill that took place near the coast of Alaska. $80 million was spent. Doesn't seem like much now with the numbers we hear in this year. But at a special ceremony to honor all the cleanup of the spill, two of the most expensively saved animals were being released. In fact, the cost, I misstated it, the cost of rehabilitating these special seals, two of them, was $80 million. Because the cleanup, the spill was in the billions. But as the whole crowd watched, this was a big media event, and they're releasing these expensively saved seals back into the wild amidst cheers and applause from the crowd. A minute later, in full view of everyone, a killer whale came and ate both of them. That's irony. This one, I had to get a European one because, you know, we have people from all continents here at this conference, and so there was a great European irony. Two animal rights defenders were protesting the cruelty of sending pigs to a slaughterhouse in Bonn, Germany. And suddenly, this was planned. This part wasn't planned. 2,000 pigs broke loose and escaped through a broken fence, and they were stampeding madly. The interesting thing about it was they had organized a protest, and there were two protesters there with the signs, and they were trampled to death by the pigs. That's irony. But this might be my favorite one. Woman came home to find her husband in the kitchen, shaking and moving around frantically, almost in a dancing frenzy, with some kind of wire running from his head to his waist. And she saw that he was near the stove with a kettle of water, and she thought, oh my goodness, he must be electrocuting himself. So intending to jolt him away from the deadly current, she whacked him in the head with a handy plank of wood, breaking his arm in two places. He was really listening to his Walkman while he was making himself a cup of coffee. Just observing the signs around us, we see irony. And for this reason, I cannot deny that God has authored irony. We find irony in Scripture. And why not? God is one who heals the sin sick. God is one who redeems the lost. God is one who resurrects the dead. So why wouldn't he be an author of irony? But as I said, you can see signs of irony all around. For example, I particularly enjoy this one. You can barely read the label says Rust-Oleum stops rust. You can barely read the stops rust. I particularly enjoy this next one. This American Flying School. This is probably not the best advertisement for flying. I've seen this particular one several times. There is a difference between paradox and contradiction, but that does not seem to be clear to the masses. Another one I enjoy. The sign says, if you cannot see it, closed, please try again. Safe driving school. So I wonder if that's what the person, the driver, was doing. Saw the sign on the door said closed, and they were just trying again. But this is probably my favorite of the lot. For those who might not be able to see it in the back, this dog appears to recognize the uselessness of this sign. It's a sign with a dog and a cross, and you know, do not, no dogs allowed. So we see as the dog carries it off a certain insight here as to why the sign was first installed. Oh, I think I have one or two more. I know you like this kind of thing. One always needs a snack after a Weight Watchers meeting. Well, since we're having fun, I might as well show you a few more. This sign may be too small to read, but this is at a bridge. You can see the bridge in the background, perhaps over the water, and it's the sign was there to help prevent suicide attempts. And the sign says, crisis counseling, there is hope, make the call. The consequences of jumping from this bridge are fatal and tragic. Now, underneath where the phone is, it says temporarily out of service. Use your cell phone. What can we say? Okay, one more. I always wonder what traffic engineers are thinking. It is certainly not what the rest of us are thinking, but I think we may all become experts on irony. Why? Well, on my next slide, my first bullet, I don't have to preach to the choir, but I bet you all recall that we were one time anti-Trinitarian. correct? Oh, have we come a long way. I don't have to talk about that. You know, and just appreciate we're not there anymore. Second bullet, I want to show you that we used to teach that the new covenant had not yet arrived. Now, this was something that was not fully in the awareness of most members or even ministry. And we were known as an old covenant church. But the truth of the matter is, Herbert Armstrong wrote an opus magnum on it that was published a couple of times in the old worldwide news, in which he explained that the new covenant doesn't arrive until Christ's second coming. And the old covenant, of course, is fulfilled with Jesus' death, so that put us in some no man's land, in between the covenant's time, which gave him a platform from which to pick and choose what he thought we should keep from the old covenant and what we shouldn't. And of course, Sabbath, holy days. You know, I can say Leviticus 11 to many, many Christians, and they just look at me and with a blank stare. But I bet you know what's in a Leviticus 11. And isn't it fun to be on a new covenant diet? Yeah. So we recognize that error, and we're thankful that we recognize that error. And we now talk about, we teach, we think about this paracritic nature of God and how in His nature, Father, Son, Holy Spirit make space for each other, deferring to each other, and that in the person of Jesus we have a new life. They make space for us. They include us in their life. And Jesus Himself said, "In my Father's house are many mansions. I go there to prepare a place for you." He's making space for us. Another part of our ultimate irony was that we were exclusive. I'm sure everyone recalls the colorful, quaint phrases we used to use in the past, that we were the one and only true church, we were the authentic and true Christians. All those other ones going to church on Sunday were disobedient Christians, Christians falsely so called. I don't need to go on. You remember that. We were quite exclusive. I remember growing up with my two sisters. I'm the oldest, and they weren't really interested in my stuff. They weren't interested in my clothes. They weren't interested in my toys. They were very interested in my candy. I never really had some kind of immense sweet tooth, and I just kind of throw my candy in the drawer. Aunts and uncles were always giving us candy, and my mother was saying, "Don't eat that, you know, save that." So I'd save it. So I had I had drawers full of candy, but I'd catch my sisters taking it, and so I'd go tell on them. Well, because I learned that hitting them wasn't approved by my dad or my mom. So then I'd go report them, and I was a big fan of Perry Mason, and I remember saying, "Mom, on purpose, deliberately, with forethought of will and premeditated, they are taking my candy." And that worried my parents. But you know, when you condemn the celebration of Jesus' birth, when you condemn the proclamation all other Christians are making to love Jesus, our approach was unmistakable of one of shooting them down. If I could give you one little video clip that encompasses what we were like as a church and how we interacted with other churches, this is the video clip I would pick.
Thank you. Rifleman.
But we don't do that anymore. Praise God. And so I don't want you to miss the irony here. We went from an exclusivist, anti-Trinitarian, half-old covenant promoting, and I'll stop there, but I could go on, to become as Trinitarian as we can get. Isn't it good? And we now recognize and teach that Jesus brought the new covenant into force and included us in his redemptive work and in his kingdom now. Yeah, what a recap. And because of that exclusivity, we were going to become obsolete. And if it not had been for God's intervention, we would have become obsolete. You can see it with our brothers and sisters in those splinter groups. You know they keep splintering. The biggest one is not the biggest one anymore of the splinter groups. They've split in half, if you hadn't heard. They play a game of musical chairs, just switching places. They don't have tremendous growth. So besides being doctrinally infirmed, legalistic, exclusive, some would say that we were going to become obsolete. I acknowledge that. We were like all those signs reduced to one sign. That's how we were. Ah, but not so with God. God has not made us redundant. He redeems us from being obsolete. The essence of God's nature, as we all now know, is love. And his focus upon humanity in his plan has God redeeming us in more ways than we can count. God is in the business of redeeming and healing. He orchestrated so many things throughout history. We read in the Bible, and we know from our own testimonies, he's orchestrated so many things in our individual lives and collectively that it just can't be denied. My presentation will continue from the last two conferences to illustrate how and where our fellowship and our organization continues to join Jesus in his ministry, where he is giving birth to new things and resurrecting and giving new life to old things. It's been interesting retrospectively as well as prospectively in that we were so exclusive in our past that our doing outreach ministry has been the equivalent of doing a spiritual version of the Hokey Pokey, that dance. Now, on the slide, I give you the definition of the Hokey Pokey. A circle dance with a synchronized shaking of the limbs in turn, accompanied by a simple song. It is, if you will, a primer or primer, if you're from the South, for children to learn how to dance. They learn how to move around together, to make space freely for each other as they move around together in a circle. Just as an also-ran, the second definition is the name of an ice cream in New Zealand. It's honeycomb and sponge toffee together. And there are other definitions that we don't need to go into, but, you know, the pokey by itself is a jail cell. You've all heard that slang. And our legalism was quite a jail cell. And hokey is a word we use that means something contrived, something that's clearly not genuine, but rather corny or mawkish or modish, sentimental kind of thing, unnecessarily melodramatic. But you put them together and you have a whole new concept of hokey pokey. Whatever space you make for Jesus as you freely move within the freedom he gives, he fills up. And as you move, every place you make a space, Jesus fills up. So that spiritually, we are all literally dancing the hokey pokey with him. we can look at today's situation in the world, and you may discern, perhaps as never before, that the heart of everything that is holy and that the heart of everything is the holy and relational Trinity. And there's a dance taking place, and we're part of that dance as God is ushering His kingdom into being like a three-stage rocket. First stage being His first coming, second stage being now, the time in which we live as He lives in us. And the third stage, when He returns and we experience the fullness of that kingdom. From Einstein to Heisenberg, there's been an ongoing investigation of physics. Physicists are learning new things literally daily. And the world is bubbling with processes and interrelatedness at the microscopic level. Things that are just being discovered. No longer are things viewed as only having an equilibrium and a stability, but rather a dynamic intertwining of continuing developments. Subatomic physicists call that dynamic interplay. In theology, we call that perichoresis. From God's self-revelation in the world, we're learning that we're being made in God's image, restored in that image that He intended from the beginning, to be a reflection of that relational dynamic that takes place in the inner life of God. Creation itself is intended to be a reflection of that. The God who so lovingly created it all and set that in order in a mind-blowing way, that science still is discovering new things. We seek to be a Trinitarian ecclesiology of perichoresis. I love putting all those words together. I had to write them down to make sure I could say them. In other words, the better we dance together, the better we join Jesus in His ministry. Our spiritual formation is completely based on the life of the Trinity, the life of God. And so, as I showed in that picture, we dance. And the better we get at dancing, the better we are at joining Jesus in ministry. And no doubt, because Jesus is the one leading us in worship. He came to reveal the Father, and the Holy Spirit convicts us that that's what Jesus did. And we now know and teach that to be Christian is to participate in the life of God through Christ. I have to tell you, my whole Christian life, until I understood the nature of God, I never thought that I was participating in the life of God. To worship is to do what is worthy. It's a really fair definition of Christian ethics. Now, in the last round of conferences, I showed you some video clips, some good and bad dancing, but I only suggested that we ought to be dancing. I'm flat out saying it now. We need to be dancing with Jesus to join Him in His ministry. On John 15, verse 26, I believe that was read this morning at the devotional. There it is. Thank you. When the Counselor comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who goes out from the Father, He will testify about Me. And then there's that sentence that I just used to never really read. Or I read it and kind of looked over it. But it clearly says, and you must also testify. When Jesus said, you are the light of the world, what on earth did He mean? We have a responsibility to reflect Jesus. There's a certain quality within the mission of Jesus that he seems to expect His followers to duplicate, to replicate in the approach of Jesus to the world. And the implications of the triune nature of God are always in play. where he says of himself, "Those who have seen me have seen the Father." He says similarly of his disciples. We're to love one another so that the world may believe. "As you sent me into the world," Jesus tells us, "so I have sent them into the world." So evidently, conceding to the truth of Jesus' identity is never a static decision. It's not something that should only be made in private. "Do you love me?" Jesus asked Peter. "Lord, you know I love you." "Well, then feed my sheep," came the reply. We're to be reflecting the light of Jesus. Wherever claims of Christ are made, in a community inherently follows. For Christians, we are ushered into the kingdom with a vastly different order, with a vastly new view of authority in our lives. We live in the kingdom now, meaning he is our Lord and Master now. And that should affect the way we live and the way we share our lives with others. It should be a testimony. It should be, as we read about, reflecting the light. Light refuses to be hidden. Don't we notice this every morning? I do when it, here in this time zone, seems to come up 3 hours earlier than I want. Recently, I was reading a book by another Trinitarian theologian, George Hunsinger. It's called Called and Sent to Represent the Reign of God. And he made a statement in it that just kind of resonated with me. He said, "This is how we are able to be the light of the world, because together we are millions of mirrors reflecting the God of light." Now, sadly, sometimes those mirrors are facing in all the wrong directions and blinding each other. We need to reflect it better to the world. And the church really doesn't know these lone rangers. I mean, they're part of the invisible church, but they're an anomaly. To be really healthy and ministering with Jesus, we ought to all be part of an ecclesiology, part of a dance with others. And what we've been learning together is a new way to do discipleship, a new way to be in relationship with others. Because in the past, our exclusivity took us away from former friends, took us away from family. I mean, I still recall my Christmas when I was 4 years old, because that's when we stopped keeping Christmas. And my poor Aunt Mary, my dad's oldest sister, gave me a Roy Rogers gun in a holster for my birthday, December 23rd. And I took that and said, "Yeah." I mean, what else would a four-year-old want? At that time, I thought I was just living large. And I was playing with it, and my parents saw it and said, "Now, where'd you get that?" "Oh, Aunt Mary gave it to me for my birthday." "Well, don't you know we don't do birthdays? Didn't we tell you that? Now you go give it back to Aunt Mary." So I did. Aunt Mary said, "Well, that's okay. Christmas is in just 2 days. You keep that for Christmas." Problem solved! I was home playing with that Roy Roger pistol and holster. Oh man, living large once again. Parents like, "Didn't I tell you to take that back to Aunt Mary?" "Well, I did." "Well, didn't you explain we don't keep birthdays?" "I did." "Well, then what are you doing with it?" "She said I could have it for Christmas." "Well, we don't do that either." "Take it back again." Wow. The level of our exclusivity seemed to know no bounds. Today, we do the opposite. Two things we do with our discipleship: we now invest in people. We look to make friends. We are about as unexclusive as we can be now. And second, We don't just invest in people inside our fellowship. We invest in people outside our fellowship. We're in a blessed place now. And I wish that I could have had you all with me for the last several years to see the things I see, to hear the things I hear. You know, it's like all the pieces of the puzzle are floating in the air, and I think, are they ever going to fit together? Well, you know, as time has moved forward, more and more of those pieces are fitting together and falling in place in our laps. It's a fantastic thing to see. So, for the rest of my presentation, I'm going to show more of those slides like I do every year. I have to be careful because our missionary missionary type people are here at this conference, and I thought they're going to use up all my stuff, but they didn't. There's more to show. On this slide, you will recall we talked about the church under the tree that came about in South Africa and how it's grown. And for those who were at the dinner tonight, you heard Tim McGuire explain how they're building their own building and things are progressing. Church has spun off to the north. Well, Canada, as a mission project, paid for them all to have a summer camp. So the church under the tree is got more and more of our DNA because, as Dan said on the opening day, we do camps right. And Good Camping International is what GCI also stands for. So they got to go to a camp. And there is a sign traveling towards Namibia, because there's a new church going up there, and Kalanguli gave me a picture of the sign, which I wanted to share with you. And another church under the tree is going to take place. So no longer will we call the church under the tree, since they're having their own building in South Africa, the church under the tree. We now have to it's going to be the Church Under the Tree Award in Africa. And the new church under the tree is now going to be in Namibia. And I hope that in the next 5 years, we have hundreds of new churches under hundreds of new trees. This is our latest German evangelist. As you might expect or have heard, if you talk to Santiago, who's our ministry leader in Germany, he will tell you that it is an anti-Christian country. And that's okay if people won't talk about Jesus. Dogs will bring people to him. This is their dog, Joy. And interesting story. Santiago and Elke live in an area, and I've been to their home. It's a nice little residential kind of cul-de-sac area. And they're new to the area. They're just meeting their neighbors. And they got this dog. And you know what dogs do when you go outside? Dogs meet other dogs. They find other dogs. Dogs don't seem to be quite as exclusive as humans can be at times. I mean, exclusive is what I'm saying. Yeah. So they found another dog, and they found the owner of that dog. As it turns out, they're talking to that owner of that dog, and they're building a relationship over time. And they discover that this person used to work at Honeywell, back here in the States. And that person worked in an office with a person named Lila Milhoff, one of our pastor's wives in Tucson, and that they went to this church. And they got to talking, and Santiago divulged, well, I'm in that church. Anyway, out of that meeting of the dogs that led to the meeting of the people, they now have 11 people. And Santiago's working on planting a church there. But Germany being such a barren place for Christianity, all hope is not lost, because We also have one of our older deacons, 70 years old, who's got his own house church going, and he's become sort of the grandfather figure to a lot of these 20 to 30 somethings in the neighborhood, and they all get together with him on a monthly basis. And when we had our church anniversary, they're all in Munich, and when we had our church anniversary, I think they drove 3 hours to come to it. So we're seeing some good commitment there. I love seeing that kind of thing happen. I love seeing a place that seems dead to Christianity start experiencing some resurrection. Next slide, I'll take you to Africa. This is a congregation in Arusha that asked to join GCI, and so they're finalizing that. The reason that they came in contact with us was finding our website and reading about our theology. And the good news is that KK met with them in February, and this, he's going to meet with them again a second time, but he also got to meet with some of their leaders. Here they are. And the really good news is that there are 16 other congregations that are overseen by this group. And I'm hoping that maybe one of these folks will end up at our conference in Nairobi, Kenya, which will be later this year in November. I ask you to pray about that conference for safe travel and good organization on the whole event. And in fact, we have our national ministry leader from Kenya is here today. If Anthony is out there, I wouldn't be able to see. Stand up, Anthony, and just wave your hand so people can see you're here. And and I want to mention my special thanks to the Washington, D.C. congregation pastored by Brian Carlisle, who sponsored Anthony to come here to this conference. So, good on ya. Next, I'll take you to Burundi. This is a picture of Pastor Eugene and his family. He oversees 5 churches, and there are a few administrative procedures remaining. But he wants to join us too, and KK has met with them, and he will meet with them again. And this last time he met with him, he was telling me that Pastor Eugene was a bit angry with KK because he's already changed the name of his church to GCI. And, you know, Colin Gooley was trying to tell him, well, you know, we haven't quite agreed on everything, but this guy's eager. He wants it now. So, KK was able to meet with 63 of his leaders from various congregations. And off the top of my head, I don't recall how many congregations they have, but it's really an explosive growth that that we see happening here. And all I can do is praise God for it and thank Him for answering our prayers. There are 2 things I've been praying about for 10 years. One is that we would become a church planting movement. And I think in the most incipient phase of it, we're starting to see that. And the second is that we could experience some explosive growth. And wow, I didn't know what I was asking. Because we're experiencing it most definitely in Africa. Next, I'll take you to another place in Kenya, the Migori District. Back to Kenya. We have some established churches there. They're doing well. And we have a school with our congregation here. The school has 350 students. So it's a good-sized school. And they do a good job. The school helps vulnerable children and orphans as well. Last year we had 16 students from the school who sat for their secondary school entry exams, and 14 of the 16 passed, so they're doing a quality job. And it's not always the U.S. and Canada that is involved in in giving donations to help. In this particular case, it's Australia, the Wollongong congregation, that is partnered with them, and they're building more classrooms, adding to the building. And this next picture shows the staff. The person on your left, most left, is Joseph Nyakawa, and he is passionate about helping widows and orphans. And the person next to him is the principal of the school, and the other three are pastors that support the school. So we have more churches wanting to join us. And you know what's interesting is the same thing that happened here, where we found Brother Lorenzo Arroyo and Ibertikis and Manuel Ochoa, who are all here at our conference. Besides finding that they were on a parallel path with us, and we came together, and those groups from the Church of God Seventh Day who joined us, the same thing is happening in Africa. There are 5 churches in Tanzania and 6 in Western Kenya from the Church of God Seventh Day who are now seeking to join us. So something is really happening there. I'm impressed with that. I used to be really good friends with the president of Church of God Seventh Day, Wade Rose, and he used to invite me to their ministerial conferences, and I would gladly go. In fact, one day Dan and I went there, 1 year Dan and I went there, and were asked to explain why we no longer keep the Sabbath. And of course, we try to explain it's because Jesus is our Sabbath, and they sort of understood, but sort of didn't. And then they just really didn't want us to come back to their conferences. But I just found out today that their president, Wade Rose, who I've been good friends with, is very much a fan of Trinitarian theology, and apparently has announced he's going to resign from his position as president, so, and start a ministry to try and help people understand these things. You see how God is doing something? When it even doesn't look like anything's happening, something's happening. So let's continue on. That's a picture of one of the classrooms with the students. And now we'll go to Lagos. In Nigeria, they recently had a conference. And just to show you that we've got stuff going on in Nigeria, we had 23 pastors and wives meet for retreat here in Ijesha. This is our headquarters building in Nigeria, and that's where they had the conference. And there's more of this kind of thing going on in Ghana, Liberia, and Gambia, and wherever KK and Tim McGuire have the money and the time to travel to. So please keep them in your prayers, and please pray that God will continue to resource us to keep going to these places and meeting with the people who want to join us. I used to sit around and worry about, you know, what's going to happen. We have an aging ministry. Who's going to take... Well, I'll just tell you this story. Sitting around the board table, looking at the board members, and I don't want to mention what each per... Well, maybe I can. You know, they each have health issues. And, I look at poor Bernie. Bernie Schnippert usually isn't there to look at. He's on a phone connection, and he has carcinoid tumors, and, you know, he probably only has 5 to 10 years left if the treatment continues to work for him. And then Mike Fazell had to retire early for health issues, but praise God, he's doing better in almost every single one of them, and may even get him back working a bit, doing more interviews. But at the time, he hadn't fully recovered as I was thinking about this. And then Karen Catherwood, who's here, one of our board members, long, long time pastor and minister in our church, and he has some type of a blood cancer. I don't even think the doctors have a name for it, but it seems to be in remission, and he seems to be doing okay. And Russell Duke, he has blood pressure medication that he takes, and I was sitting there, I think, my goodness, when is the shoe going to drop on old Joe?
I'm feeling pretty healthy and perky, but I see what happens here as you get older. And so who's going to take the place of all those people sitting around the table? And who's going to take my place? Well, in the last few years, I have seen our younger leaders emerge, and we're taking them around and giving them more opportunities and showing them off more. One of them is Eber Tkach. I've traveled a few places with Eber and hope to travel a few more to him. For those who saw Dan's presentation on Wednesday, he talked about Eber, and Eber has planted a church. He pastors a church in Sun Valley area of Los Angeles, but he planted a new church in the Lincoln Heights area of Los Angeles. And it's a long story, but to make it short, he's averaging 70 in attendance, and I have a few pictures of his congregation here to share with you to show you it's real. Eber went with us to Guadalajara, Mexico, and if you were here and saw Dan's presentation, Lorenzo got up and talked about going to Guadalajara, and we had a really good conference in Guadalajara a year ago, and it went so well that Leroyo said, well, let's do it again. So this time I said, all right, I'll kick it up a notch. So Tammy and I, Kathy and Gary Dedo, and Lorenzo and Rita Arroyo and Eber all came. And what was fun was they still remembered the conference from last year, because that last year, Ted Johnson and Randy Bloom and I went without our wives. And we saw how wonderful Guadalajara is and what a safe city it is, so we brought the wives the next year. But I introduced Ted as Señor Rascacielo, which means skyscraper in Spanish. And I introduced Randy Bloom as Señor Guapo, which means handsome in Spanish. Now, that's my sense of humor, but what was really funny is some people thought that was really his name. But it was such a good conference that first year that they wanted us to come back, and so for Lorenzo, I kicked it up a notch, and we had a really wonderful conference, and it was well attended. And as you can see from that picture, and there's a picture of Gary doing a session, and they had one session one day where Gary and Kathy and Tammy and I got to go into the city and look around, and the whole day was in Spanish that day. And an interesting thing came. You'll see a picture of this family seated around the table. A fellow in the middle of the table is named Jose Vasquez. He's the brother of one of our longer-time members named Jesus Vasquez, and he's an assistant pastor in our congregation in Moreno Valley, the Spanish-speaking congregation. And Jose, Jesus' brother, was attending a Baptist church in Aguascalientes, down in Mexico, which is a city that is about 2 hours' drive from Guadalajara. Well, this Baptist church just kind of fell apart and disintegrated, and he had been on his own with about 8 other families, and wasn't quite sure what to do, and so he was talking to his brother Jesus on the phone, and he said, go to Guadalajara, go to the conference. And so he did, and he became absolutely ensconced in Trinitarian theology, and they had a commissioning ceremony for him, and he's gone back and is planting a church back in his area. Here's a picture of the youth group in Guadalajara. And so two people there, Samuel Mercado and Eber Tkach, ministered to the group over there. And Nathaniel Cruz is really an interesting fellow. He's now our pastor of the Mexico City Church. And he's got another church plant going in a place called Zambonga or something like that, and which has 15 adults and 5 children already in attendance. And he is musically gifted. He's written over 40 worship songs, and he led us in worship at the conference, and some are with a Caribbean flair, and others are a big band sound, and we went through several of them, and he's quite talented. So I was hopeful to get him here at the conference, but he doesn't have a passport and couldn't get one in time to make the conference. I always have to give a quick nod to the Philippines. I think if the Philippines was the headquarters of our church, we might have already tripled in size. They are a jewel in our fellowship. They have a fearless devotion to evangelism, a fearless devotion to trying new things. And where's the Guzans? Eugene is here with his wife Lulu and their daughter, Joyce, and husband Aaron. If you're here, stand up. I just want to say good on you all. But they're in their ninth year of operating Ambassador School for Children, now serving 134 students. If they had more money, they'd serve more students. You get a good bang for your buck in the Philippines too. And so I wanted to give them a plug, a shameless plug. I'll mention Thailand because the Filipinos have gone there and started Rabim. I know that sounds Hebrew, but it isn't. It stands for Rayong Bible Ministries. And it's in southern Thailand. And they just celebrated in December their fifth anniversary of being there. And they've got more things going on in Thailand in this one little group than probably any three or four of our U.S. congregations. That's a picture of them at the celebration. That's a picture of them, I believe that's with the at one of their parties. But they have a juvenile ministry. It started in 2008, and they meet with people who, let's say, are delinquent when it comes to following the laws. And they have these groups of students. They also sponsor an orphanage, and they do new outreach all the time. And they're never afraid to start new things. So there's more pictures of them. And I have to give a shameless plug to our website. You know, sometimes technology is designed to connect us and bring us closer together, but ends up paradoxically doing the opposite. Our website is something I can't even wrap my head around. I do think it was very nicely designed, and we continue to add more content to it all the time, but our website is a ministry on its own. People are drawn in contact with us by first seeing our website. And Dustin Lamp is another fellow who is now the associate pastor in Cincinnati, Rick Schallenberger's old congregation. There's a few of those folks here too. I say that affectionately. I'm old too now. And these people first came in contact with us through our website. And it's not just our website. Some of the websites in other regions are doing the same thing. I show you a picture of the UK website. And some of the things that have been produced as a result of people coming to those websites, because they're all connected to our Glendora website. And so I show you a picture of this couple in Croatia. This is in their home. They're both craftsmen who make things out of glass, as you might be able to discern from looking at the pictures of all the things they've made out of glass. And his name is Darko Velupic, and he wrote this letter. Dear in the Lord, I found your site on the internet and like to me. You have good principles and cute name. Well, obviously, his command of English is not bad, because my command of speaking what they do in Croatia is not good. Do you have any church in Croatia or interest to cooperate with us? A few of us study the scriptures as a home group in the city of Koprivnica. There is no real Christian church here, only Catholics, which we left. Can you recommend us some church or how to create a church? Do you have any more learning materials? Please send me some. So James Henderson is in contact with them. Let me show you another another interesting development. Guess what that is? I know we don't read Arabic. I don't either. But that in Arabic says Grace Communion International. And you may remember last year I told you about the few folks from Casablanca area and Morocco rode in, wanted to get baptized, and James Henderson went in there and baptized a few, and he's gone back, and he's going back again. Well, they are interested now in making a website, and it is they who are putting this together. When it looks like nothing's happening in Casablanca, don't be fooled. Something is happening. I don't know if you recall last time I presented the picture here of Deb and Sam and his wife, and they operate the church in Kathmandu. I know you thought that was just some song in a rock and name in a rock and roll song, but no, there's a real place, and they've established a close working relationship with Rod Matthews, who's been there. And here's a picture of their church, Himalayan Gospel Church. And this is the entrance in Mohan, and Mohan Jayasekara, whose wife, Nihara, is undergoing some chemotherapy treatment for cancer. Otherwise, they would be here. So please pray for her. Otherwise, they would be here. Anyway, Mohan, Rod Matthews, and Rick Schallenberger all went there. And if you've probably caught on, if the place has way too much humidity, I asked Rick to go. But here's a picture inside. They bring food for the widows, people who have extra food or grow food, bring food and they share it. Here's their worship team, which I believe is comprised by some of Deben's children. And here's another gathering, and there you see proof that Rick was there. I'm showing that for those Cincinnati members, that the money was well spent. Here's a picture of Deepa, which is Deben's sister. And Rod tells me every time he goes to Nepal, Deben is doing something new. And it's not just that he does something new, he does something spectacular. And since partnering with Deben, he's established a farm growing vegetables, a fish breeding pond, and he does all this to help sustain the poor families and widows and the orphans. He does have 14 orphans in rural areas in a home with his wife and sister and sister-in-law, and they help look after them. What a heart to serve. And so here's a picture of the fish farm. Here's a picture of the vegetable farm. And he's really interested in proclaiming the vast gospel, and he's going to these little villages in places I've never heard of. Here's a picture of the Gatlang village where he's going. And it's a 3 to 7 hour walk along mountain trails. And these are small villages that range between 30 people and 350 people. And Deben goes there. Here's another picture of the village from a different perspective. Yeah. Now, something really cool is he wants written material. Deben says that 95% of the pastors, Christian pastors in that area of Nepal, have no opportunity to attend a seminary or gain theological training. So they're very weak in their capacity to preach from Scripture, to expound the Bible. And so Deben wants to do something about that too. So he wants to start a seminary. And guess what two publications were done first in the Nepalese language? How to Become a True Disciple of Jesus Christ, as well as Basic Christian Teachings from GCI, translated into Nepalese. And he does amazing things with small amounts of money. And he gets bits from some of our congregations, but very few. But here's where I want to point out that it's not just Canada and it's not just the U.S. Australia picks up the slack too for this part of the world and supports a lot of people there. Here's another picture of the village. And here is another shot of it from a higher angle. And here is a family, their living arrangement. Danny Zachariah is here, and his wife, and I think his son, too. If you're here, stand up, Danny, because India's a long way. There he is, right in front of me. This year they had a summer camp where there were 27 children aged 4 to 14, and they had a blessing of the children there upon them. That's not a bad thing to do, advertise you're going to have a blessing of the children thing at your church. Grandparents like to bring kids for that. Here's a picture of their summer camp. And another. And another. And I can't do a presentation without mentioning my good friend John Biswa. They're working on completing a multi-purpose mission center building in Bangladesh. The one that they had before was ruined by the flood waters and all the extreme kind of climate that takes place there, the tsunamis, the floods, the cyclones, and names of things that I don't even know. Anyway, they're making progress on that building. The costs have quadrupled since they started. And John Biswa is quite a talented fundraiser. At least that's what a lot of pastors tell me. But we have contributed significantly from Glendora to help this building and hope to give him another tranche of cash to help him finish it. And again, because of our website, things happen. This came from Guyana. The Speaking of Life programs have been on local TV since the first week in December 2012, once per month, 7:30 p.m. for 3 months. I renewed for the second 3 months, that is March to May 2013. God is providing for the payments for the program. He works in unexpected ways. The girl at the TV station asked me to tell Mr. Tkach hello. They like the short, to-the-point programs. I even had a chat with the lady owner of the station when she came into the office to see me while I was making payment for the last 3 months. One pastor told me that one station manager allows it to be played for free because she likes it. I know a few other pastors have told me they're buying time on local radio stations, and it's not too exorbitant to buy 3 minutes and have the clip played. That was never my idea or intention, but I don't see it as a bad one, so pray move forward with it, my brothers and sisters. We're always getting letters, and I wanted to share one or two with you. Dear Pastor Tkach and Tammy, I greet you in the name of our Lord. I was visited your web and much interest in your ministry. I am Pastor Daniel Kung, serving the Lord's ministry in Mandalay City, which is the second capital city in Myanmar. We are a Grace Evangelical Church with 8 local churches and holds the doctrine of grace, grace alone. We have 2 mission fields to unreached area and organize 36 orphans in care, some widows. Please pray for us for the ministry in here. Let me invite you to have a vision and interest to come to train our ministers, about 30 in number, for a week. And if you can support us for the cost of that seminar, we will be much blessing and benefit for our future. We need more train from you. So I share this one as just sort of an archetype that this is the kind of letters that we get. And if we had an endless amount of cash, we would go to all these places. So we have to pick and choose and do what with what money we have. And it's not just that place. There are other places, and my time is fleeting, so I'm not going to read them all. Well, here's one from another one from Myanmar. I don't know, you'd think Myanmar was the hotbed of Christianity by the letters I'm getting from there. But just a couple last slides as I come to conclude. To emphasize your importance of inviting people to the table with you, to the Lord's table with you, inviting people into the circle of dance, to do the hokey pokey with you. Look at how many people come to church. The first category by some promotional gospel meeting. It's half a person. Some people just visit. One person might come to your church and stay just by a random visit. or three who walk in deliberately with will of forethought on purpose, and they might stay. That's how many, the percentage out of 100, 3%. Ministry programs only get 3%. Special needs gets 3%. Bible classes get 5%. Ministers going out and talking to people and interacting get 6%. 79% come to church because a friend or relative invited them. We want to grow. We got to teach people to dance the hokey pokey with Jesus because it's what it's all about. Now, I want to conclude with some humor. The day that Einstein feared may be now. He said, I fear the day that technology will surpass our human inaction. The world will have a generation of idiots. Now, that's funny, but I think it's harsh. I don't think we have a generation of idiots. But I can't help but notice this observation. Having coffee with friends, they're all looking at their smartphones. I'm not, but the Einstein quote may not be right all the time or apply to all things. Here's a day at the beach, they're looking at their cell phones. Here's cheering on your team. Now, he very well may be texting another fan, you know, telling him the score. Here's dinner out with your friends. Now, this one I can't defend. Out on a romantic date. Visit to the museum. Now, look, they may be wanting to know more about the author. And you can Google it right there on your phone. But in contrast, we want to use our technology to build relationships, not to fragment it. And that's why we continue to develop our website, and I encourage all pastors to develop websites in their local area. It's a medium for which young people are drawn to and participate. And so we try to consciously change the center of attention. I have tried to consciously change the center of attention from me as the president, me the pastor general, because this is the way things were done in the past. The focus was all on me or my office or whatever. I've tried to not be the focus, but rather try to shine the light on Jesus as the one we focus upon and the one who with whom we participate with ministry. But what I do consciously try to do in my ministry and in my effort to lead our fellowship is to make room for people at the table. When people sense that they are wanted, when they sense that they are loved, when they are sense that they have a place, then you will witness real transformation. And certainly you cannot deny Jesus has made a place for all of us. Has he not? I'll conclude with a nice little story. It's true that one of our pastors in Indianapolis, David Perry, told me. David did a wonderful project that he helped coordinate from his congregation in Indianapolis. He wanted to get bicycles for our pastors in Mozambique. You know, when the churches in Mozambique first came and asked to join us, they were about 79 working on their 80th church plant. By the time KK got to them, they had 86 churches. Today, they're 96 churches. And they're poor, and they don't have cars, but the pastors are energetic, and some of them have bicycles. The megachurch pastors there have bicycles. And so David Perry wanted to help even the playing ground and started a fundraising project to help me get bicycles for our pastors in Mozambique. And, of course, he coordinated that with Tim McGuire, and they got a bunch of bicycles there, so we have a fleet program now in Mozambique. But the interesting thing that to David was that, you know, sometimes people would give a large check and they can afford it, and that's fine, and he got some nice donations from different places. But there was one group of six elderly folk out in the Colorado area, as I recall, and they didn't have much, but they wanted a place at the table. They wanted to be in on this good stuff. They wanted to dance, even if all they could put in was not their whole foot or their whole leg or their whole arm. If it was just their little toe or their little finger, they wanted to be part of that dance. And all that those six people could give was $50. But that helped buy a bike. When you make room at the table, more people will come. And Jesus is the most exquisite host you can possibly find. Join me in prayer. We come to you, Father, thankful for being the source of every good and perfect gift, which we know you sent in the person of Jesus. And as he ascended and takes us with him, the Holy Spirit comes right in behind to strengthen, to encourage, to point us to Jesus. We thank you for the wonderful being that you are. We thank you for how you have lifted us out of being nearly obsolete. We thank you for bringing us from such a ridiculous exclusiveness, such a naive exclusiveness. We also thank you for showing us your very nature and for calling us to co-minister with you. We recognize this privilege, and each year as we've moved forward, we've seen your touch. We thank you for that. And we pray, Jesus, that you never stop touching us, that you continue to gift us, that you continue to resource us to go the places you want us to go and to do all those things you have for us to do. Some of those things we don't even see yet. So thank you. Thank you for every person here. And we pray that this conference lifts each one of them. In Jesus' name, amen.